here in Southeast Florida, we are one of the most sea level rise vulnerable places on the earth.
It could be a sunny day, and we could have two weeks of a lot of water. And I'm not talking about a puddle here and there.
No one wants to pay increased taxes or fees, but if people want to live here, we have to make these investments to do the infrastructure planning, the pump systems, all the stuff that needs to be done so that we can stay habitable.
I see no way that we could have less than 4.5 feet sea level rise by the end of the century.
I want to go over here to Joey Tomato's dock and see if the lower dock, now it looks like it's gone.
I've lived in Florida my whole life. I'm actually a native. And more importantly, I've been on Miami Beach for like 55 years. And I'm a captain. Captains are used to looking at the ocean. I'm kind of like an Indian hunter who's walking through the woods, and he knows that this was a deer that made this or scratched this tree, and he sees a twig broken. Well, that, as a captain, making my living fishing, that is what I do. So it starts out as survival, but if you look at it long enough, and I've had enough time to look at it, you can see small changes turn into big changes over a period of time. It's almost like watching slow motion from one end to the other, and you finally get to that end, and you can see what happened over a long period of time. In Miami, everyone can see this now. If you've been here, well, yesterday, and if you're here today, and you go to West Avenue on Miami Beach, you're gonna see water coming out of Biscayne Bay, up the storm sewers, and onto the streets until it's about a foot deep. And that's not fresh water, that's salt water. There's no rain, there's not a cloud in the sky. Everyone can see that. Some people go, oh, we broke a sewer main, or a water main broke. That's not what it is. That's sea level rise.
Miami Beach is a barrier island that is mostly just a few feet above water level. High tides are higher than they were in the past, and the risk of torrential rainstorms has worsened with climate change. All this means problems for Miami Beach infrastructure. Longtime residents have seen dramatic changes over the years.
We're constantly dealing with water all the time. You know, it could be a sunny day, and we could have two weeks of a lot of water. And I'm not talking about a puddle here and there. Water that spans across West Avenue, where you have to slow your car down or drive to the median in the middle because you think it's a higher level so that you're not ruining your brakes.
Tides move sea levels up and down several feet in the bays every day. But high tides are much higher during full or new moon periods and can be even more extreme when the planets align. Tides will increase even more as sea level rises. Seawalls can provide protection against storm surges and allow the ground level to be built up higher, improving drainage. Ben Moskoff is a business development officer with Shoreline Foundation, a company that builds and installs seawalls. Ben has seen the changes.
The seawall that we're looking at that's now topped by the flood water is indicative of the height of most of the seawalls on Miami Beach when they were built in the 1920s, because that was the height necessary at that time.
Scientists have been warning about these coming climate changes for years. Dr. Hal Wanless, professor and chair of the Department of Geological Sciences at the University of Miami, has been studying sea level rise for decades. His research provides a clear picture of the evolution of sea levels. He works with various task forces and councils to project sea levels for this century.
The warming we're on track to do is going to be much, much more.
The two big things that have been and will affect sea level are the expanding ocean as it warms. That's going to be sort of a linear continuation. We're going to still be transferring heat from the atmosphere to the ocean. That's what global warming is.
The second big factor affecting sea level rise now is ice melt. And the ice melt's a totally different game. Ice can melt at rapidly accelerating rates. I videoed this time-lapse footage in Greenland in August of 2013. All of this ice is new water entering the ocean. As these icebergs melt, they add to sea level rise.
South Florida political leaders have adopted a unified sea level rise projection calculated by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. These projections indicate sea levels will rise 3 to 7 inches by 2030 and 9 to 24 inches by 2060. This will mean significant impacts for South Florida.
I see no way that we could have less than 4.5 feet sea level rise by the end of the century. That is the absolute low end. Once you're thinking the reality of those, even the 4.5, our barrier islands are abandoned.
Pete Harlem knows these projections all too well. He is the GIS coordinator at Florida International University and pioneered the precise mapping of sea level rise for South Florida.
Now I'm going to go to 1 foot. On the extreme part of the tide, it can go up plus 1 foot, 1.5 feet on a very extreme tide. So now I'm going to go to 2 feet, and we'll see a bigger change. 2 feet of sea level rise is projected from roughly 2040 to 2060 sometime. And so when we get to that point, we're going to see this is the Miami Beach of that near future. The people out here on the high ground, they'll still be fairly dry. These people will be having all kinds of issues with salt water getting in their yards. Okay, this map shows 3 feet of sea level rise on South Beach. And now we can see that most of the former mangrove swamp was filled to that level. So now I've taken the water level to 4 feet. And now you can see that most of that old mangrove side of the island is completely inundated. And it's just not going to be a place you're going to want to live in a house.
And it's not just people living on barrier islands who need to be concerned about sea level rise. Most of South Florida is susceptible to flooding as infrastructure becomes overwhelmed by rising seas or heavy rainfall. Today, one of the major protections against flooding in South Florida is the intricate system of canals and flood control structures overseen by the South Florida Water Management District, the agency responsible for water resources of nearly 8 million residents who live from Orlando to the Florida Keys. Dr. Jayantha Obi-Sakira is the chief modeler and an expert in South Florida's complicated hydrologic systems.
We have a regional flood control system that was designed and built by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers jointly with the state about 50 years ago. And at that time, sea level rise was not a major factor that they didn't worry about. But now, with the increasing sea level rise we have had in the last 50 to 100 years, some of the infrastructure we have on the coastal belt are basically not working as they were designed. Particularly, there are 3 or 4 structures in Miami-Dade County, northern Miami-Dade County, that are not functioning the way they were designed for.
When we have heavy rainfall, the canals receive and move the excess water. That water is released into the bays and estuaries and eventually into the ocean. The system was designed for the water to flow by gravity, with the water flowing from the higher canal levels to the lower ocean levels. As the sea rises, however, gravity will no longer do the job, so there could be more flooding on the land as the water has nowhere to go.
That isn't just a coastal issue, that drainage and flood control management is very interconnected throughout our communities, and sea level rise has the potential to impact western communities just as much as it does in the coastal environment. In Broward County, we have about 1,800 miles of canals, and drainage and flood control for our communities is provided through a series of control gates and pumps. So when it rains, in order to provide flood control, we have to, in most cases, actively move the water off the landscape. Our ability to do that will be compromised as sea level increases, and there's really no place to discharge the water to without causing flooding somewhere else. Today we have communities where tidal flooding does occur with some regularity as water either overtops seawalls or also moves up through drainage infrastructure.
Another problem related to sea level rise is saltwater intrusion into our drinking water. Intrusion happens when saltwater moves into the freshwater aquifer. As the population of South Florida grows, Underground freshwater supplies are being depleted, allowing saltwater to push in through the porous limestone rock. As the sea level rises, this intrusion will happen much faster, pushing saltwater into the freshwater aquifers and canals.
Many municipalities, cities get water supply for the residents from groundwater. And many places, the cities, they have major well fields, basically a well drilled into what is known as the Biscayne Aquifer. It's along the coast. It's about 100 to 200 feet deep, depending on the location. But our geology is such that the rock is very porous. The water would come through this rock, so when the sea level is rising, the water would come faster through these very porous rocks towards these well fields that were constructed years ago and more closer to the coast. So the concern is that this salt water would come near the well fields as the sea level is rising faster. So these well fields are very critical for water supply for the communities along the coast in South Florida.
Beyond impacts to our drinking water, Florida residents will be affected in other ways. In July 2012, Congress made a number of changes to the National Flood Insurance Program, which provides flood insurance to homeowners. These changes are substantially increasing the rates for some policyholders.
What the changes did is that they have limited some of the subsidies that are currently included in national flood insurance for the policyholders. So, for example, the law now says that if you're insuring a second home on the beach through the National Flood Insurance Program, and it's not your primary residence, the federal government's no longer going to subsidize that. And they've also said that if you own a repetitive loss property, which is defined in statute, but typically it's just a property that's had either two claims of over $5,000 or claims that have amounted to more than the market value of the property, that we're no longer going to subsidize your policies either. So what we're already starting to see in some ways is that we as a country are realizing that we have to be careful about how we're subsidizing people to live in areas where they're at risk.
Here in Southeast Florida, we are one of the most sea level rise vulnerable places on the earth.
Richard Grosso is the director of the Environmental and Land Use Law Clinic and a professor of law at Nova Southeastern University.
It's been local utility directors, people who run water treatment plants, people who run sewage treatment plants, people who maintain roads, who have been required to institute very expensive retrofits, for example, of stormwater systems. People who have been required to budget big ticket items to keep their stormwater systems, their water treatment plants, their wastewater treatment plants from failing, from leaking, from backing up. This is something they are now dealing with on a daily basis that's impacting this year's budget.
In Miami Beach, residents are already living with impacts. In recent years, increased flooding from high tide and weather events has been a stark wake-up call for people living on South Beach.
I remember people taking pictures and laughing when we saw people canoeing down West Avenue. But then a lot of people started asking questions. Is it safe? Because is the water dirty? Can I walk around on the street even and go back into my apartment and not bring sewage into our homes? Like, so a lot of people, we may not have been galvanized on the issue of sea level rise, but it was really scary in a lot of ways that what could actually happen here.
The city of Miami Beach has begun ambitious projects to protect its real property with a taxable value estimated at $23 billion. The Miami Beach Public Works Department is working on improvements now.
We've done our stormwater management master plan that was adopted in 2012, and that had identified approximately $200 million worth of improvements that we needed to do over the next 20 years in order to keep pace with sea level rise and addressing flooding concerns within the city of Miami Beach. A lot of the decisions that we make to move forward with this are based on empirical evidence, engineering judgment, and the experts that are available out in the field giving us their best guess. And that's really what it is at this point, is the best guess. We rely on the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers projections for sea level rise. We're relying on, you know, the consultants that have expertise in this area to give us what they feel are the appropriate design parameters.
When Rick Saltrick, the former Miami Beach city engineer, came over to the Public Works Department, he thought he'd be widening sidewalks, adding bike lanes, making the city more pedestrian and bicycle friendly. Instead, he had to learn more about sea level rise and getting infrastructure installed that will help the city manage the impacts. Some of this infrastructure includes pumps.
Everything collects on the inlets on the street and then runs through those white pipes down there. They're PVC pipes. They can all drain via gravity to the stormwater pump station and then pumped out of the stormwater pump station and injected into the ground, 80 to 100 feet down. We're sizing these pumps to provide the proper level of service 20 years from now and the sea level 20 years from now. We know in 20 years we're gonna have to replace these pumps, but these structures are sized so that we can go in with the next larger size pump and put them in and provide another 20 years level of service at the higher sea level.
I think cities like Miami Beach are doing the right thing by having solutions for the near term, let's say for the next several decades. At some point, they will have to decide, you know, what are the other options that we have to implement? And what's the cost of those? I think we are not at that point yet. I think the best thing for us to do is right now is to look at the next few decades and what are the solutions that we can provide given the current rate and the expected increase in sea level.
Miami Beach is not alone in addressing sea level rise. South Florida has become a model for regional cooperation on this issue. Monroe, Miami-Dade, Broward, and Palm Beach counties have come together and formed a four-county climate change compact, a voluntary coordinated effort to better understand sea level rise and its impacts.
You have four counties that are collaborating and working together on what is a difficult and sometimes controversial issue. And those counties have been able to put aside their differences, their competition, their competitiveness, which at times, you know, can be disruptive to progress, and really work together as a very cohesive unit.
And we all came together and adopted joint sea level rise projections. That is unheard of. I don't know of any place in the country that has done a similar effort. So all four county governments decided that this is the baseline for sea level rise projections.
And over the course of the last three or four years, they have jointly gathered and collated the best available science and information about sea level, expected sea level rise impacts throughout Southeast Florida. They have compiled the best available information and recommendations about how local governments ought to best respond to sea level rise and climate change, both in terms of doing things to help slow it down and in terms of doing things to respond to that level of sea level rise, which is inevitable.
The compact's projections were turned into an action plan with more than 100 recommendations. These are now being reviewed. Some have been adopted by county governments. At the 5th annual Southeast Florida Regional Climate Leadership Summit, Bob Perciseppi, the Deputy Administrator of the United States Environmental Protection Agency, praised the compact as a model for the nation.
Hearing him say that today and understanding that we're headed down the right path was really rewarding. And I'm just super excited to get up there and get to work.
Broward County Mayor Kristen Jacobs has been at the forefront of South Florida climate change discussions and has earned national recognition for her work. She knows very well the challenges associated with turning action plans into reality.
And now it's implementation. Now it's finding the financial resources and the long-term vision to do it. I see one of the biggest hurdles for us in going forward is term limits. When you consider the leaders that are necessary, the cheerleaders that are necessary to continue pulling this very heavy train forward. We all have a rope over our shoulder and we've got to pull and pull to keep it going because finances are in short supply right now. Understanding, which makes it even more important for us to work with the federal partners, to work with each other across county lines and with the state to understand we're already spending a significant amount of monies on all kinds of different levels. We have to remember that you have a whole lot of bright staff people and a lot of very bright people in the community who are pushing for this to happen. And without that leadership, the one that casts the vote, the one that decides the budget, the one that directs their staff resources towards any given priority, if you don't have that at any point in time, all of this could fall apart.
And I take great comfort in this Southeast Florida Climate Compact because what it says to me is we're planning. Our politicians, our engineers, our scientists are coming together to put our best foot forward, to take our heads out of the sand and say, here's what's happening in Florida and here's what we can do.
But these plans come at a high price, something always politically difficult. As a member of the compact, former County Commissioner Katie Sorensen has been an advocate for planning for the coming changes.
They need to be planning for the future, not just for the short term. And so there's some conversation now that's going on from Washington down to Miami-Dade County about how we're going to approach this. No one wants to pay increased taxes or fees, but if people want to live here, we have to make these investments to do the infrastructure planning, the pump systems, all the stuff that needs to be done so that we can stay habitable.
And so I think one of the biggest challenges that we have in South Florida and across the country is this disconnect between the best long-term investment and economic strategies for a community versus a political process that is short-term in terms of its rewards. For most local elected officials, they're not going to be around. They're not going to be on that county commission. They're not going to be on that city council 20 years from now when people are saying, boy, that was really smart, that investment we made to relocate our infrastructure, to not allow that new development to go in to a sea level rise vulnerable beach area. They're not going to be around to reap the rewards of those smart, thoughtful decisions that they made 10, 20 years ago. And so that system still puts pressure on the folks who do have the power, who do have the votes, to continue to make short-term gain kinds of decisions, to yes, rebuild that damaged infrastructure just where it was, to yes, approve that new coastal development in a flood-prone area. That is our biggest challenge presented by sea level rise right now.
What I see is personally as a concern is that we're closing in on that window of opportunity where we are proactive instead of reactive. Reactive is much more expensive, very expensive. All of a sudden the political will is there because we have to do something, but proactive, there's so many more opportunities for addressing this problem or this issue in the proper way and to educate people in that process. But I would prefer to be proactive. If it has to be reactive, then it's unfortunate, but it'll be very, very expensive.
There is probably nothing that a citizen could do that's more impactful than A, find out who your state representative is, find out who your state senator is, and contact them and say, I want you to do something about sea level rise. I want you to maintain the laws or improve the laws so that my community can better plan and prepare for sea level rise.
City of Miami Beach, where I live, because they're having to do these giant infrastructure projects, stormwater sewer projects, really now has embraced the idea that we live on an island that won't be here. And they want to know how we can protect this island for the longest amount of time before we have to evacuate. And we're going to have to leave one day, but we got to get the most out of living here for the best amount of money we can spend. So you want to spend the right amount of money so that we get the longest or the best longevity of our life here on Miami Beach, as long as we can get away with it.
Thank you.